going to begin with a time of worship this morning, praising the Lord Most High in this place and just welcoming and acknowledging His presence today. So good to be in church with all of you this morning. Hallelujah. Let's sing this together. Sing, I want to see your face.
And I want to see your face. And I want to know your ways.
And let your light.
And let your light shine upon us.
Let's sing this. I want to know your power.
And I want to know your power. Come fill me once again. Lift me up in your hands of grace.
Sing and put a new song.
And put a new song in my mouth of praise to you. And the world will see and fear your name. Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you. Worthy, worthy is the Lord. Worthy, worthy is the Lord. Worthy, worthy is the Lord Most High.
Let's sing this again. I want to know your power.
Now I want to know your power.
Come fill me, Lord.
Come fill me once again. And lift me up in your hands of grace.
Sing and put a new song.
And put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name. Put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name.
Let's lift it up this morning. Sing, worthy,
worthy, worthy is the Lord, worthy.
This again, put a new song.
So put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name. So put a new song in my mouth of praise to you, and the world will see and fear your name.
Let's lift our voices this morning.
Worthy. Worthy is the Lord, worthy, worthy is the Lord, worthy, worthy is the Lord Most High.
Sing that one more time. Worthy,
worthy, worthy is the Lord, worthy. Worthy is the Lord, worthy, worthy is the Lord Most High.
Amen. Would you say amen to that this morning? Lord, we worship you because you are worthy of all of our praise this morning. Hallelujah. Well, if you're joining us for the first time this morning, we've been in a series called Follow, where we've been learning from Jesus himself through the Gospels and what it looks like to truly follow him. And so this morning, we're going to continue to just worship him and sing his praises and just worship him and declare that we will continue to follow him this morning. You go.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Yeah. I will follow you. Yeah.
Sing all your ways.
All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone.
Let's sing this again. Where you go?
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Who you love.
Who you love, I'll
how you serve.
How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah.
Line in two.
Light into the world, light into my life, and I will live for you alone. You're the one I see, knowing I will find. All I need is you alone, in you alone.
See where you go.
And where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. And if this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
In you.
In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow.
In you.
And in you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy.
Let's sing. Where you go?
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will
sing where you go.
And where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow
whom you love.
And whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
Our prayer this morning, God, that wherever you lead us, we will follow you, Lord Jesus, because you don't lead us with a heavy hand or an iron fist, but with outstretched arms of love. And Lord, it's not your judgment or your wrath that leads us, but it's your kindness, Scripture says, that leads us to repentance and to change and to follow you from glory to glory to glory. And it's because you lead us through humility and love and compassion and mercy that we long to and desire to worship you and follow you all the days of our life, Lord Jesus. And we pray that we too could live like you and lead through love and humility and compassion and kindness in our everyday lives. And so we just want to worship you and thank you for that, Jesus. Hallelujah. Open up the skies.
Open up the skies of mercy. Rain down the cleansing flood. Healing waters rise around us. Hear our cries, Lord. Let them rise.
Open up the skies.
Open up the skies of mercy. Rain down the cleansing flood.
Healing
waters rise around us.
Hear our cries.
And hear our cries, Lord. Let them rise. And it's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. And it's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. Your love is better than
Jesus, And we call you Lord because we want to place you in charge of all our lives. And it's not because of your heavy-handed leadership over our lives where you control us by a fear tactic, by saying, you better follow me or else you're going to go to hell or something like that. No, you're not like that kind of leader. The kind of leader you are is a kind that would extend your hand and say, you know, no matter what you have done, no matter your background, no matter if you still have questions about me and who I am, even if you have uncertainties about your future, I want to extend my hand. In fact, I want to extend my life to you, and I want you to follow me because I'm a kind God. I so want to have a relationship with you. And that's why I came here, to try to identify you. And in fact, I took the form of a human, a man. And 2,000 years ago, Jesus, you came and you lived out your mission on earth to identify with your people, with us. And you extend yourself as a kind, kind Savior, the one that would look past the things that we have done wrong, who would change the idea of what it means to be religious. Instead of following rules, you said, follow me as a person. And Jesus, that's the kind of God we want to follow, a person that says, you know what, I want to embrace you as someone that wants a relationship with us. So this morning, Lord Jesus, we thank you that it's your kindness that leads us to wanting to change. And Lord, the miraculous thing is we don't change ourselves. You change us. And that's amazing truth that, Lord, when we say yes to you and somehow miraculously, Holy Spirit, you come into our lives. The God of the universe would choose to inhabit our very lives and would choose to guide us, direct us. In fact, give us this sensitivity of the things we do wrong and say, you know what? That's not you anymore. You're a child of God and you can live differently because of my Spirit in your life. So this morning, Lord Jesus, we honor you as our kind, as our forgiving, as a gracious Savior. So go ahead, church. Would you give Jesus your highest praise? I'm not sure what kind of, and I use these quotes, religious background we have, because many of us can grow up very religiously. And when I say religiously, being a Christian or being a follower of some God meant you have to follow these rules, and it was about more do's and don'ts. But this morning, church, you're here because the type of religion that Jesus is kind of saying is the religion of a relationship. Can you say relationship? Relationship. Yeah, it's all a relationship, a partnership with us. And of course, there's stuff to follow, but it's that's secondary to being in a relationship with God of the universe. Isn't that good news? Yes. And no matter what we've done, where we have gone, our backgrounds, he still draws us. And that's good news. So, you know, this morning, if you can have your seats, we're going to transition a little bit. And you know, if you're visiting us for the first time, we welcome you here this morning. And, you know, if you've been back for a while, you know, we know that we're going through this series called Follow. And in this series of Follow, we have looked at Jesus from the first time he came to earth and when he first asked his 12 followers to follow him. These group of men that would eventually be the ones that would revolutionize the whole world, change the whole world, and point everyone to Jesus. What we're going to do right now is we're going to take the time to celebrate one way that we can say that we are followers of Jesus. One way, we celebrated a couple of weeks ago. And you know, we had this discussion in our small group, our Ohana group, this past Friday. What defines you as a follower of Jesus? We talked about that, and we're like, oh man, this is not an easy question. I wonder what it is. What kind of rules, what kind of things you have to do, what kind of practices? And I was thinking about that, and I had obviously my thoughts, and I thought, wow, what marks us? What, like, stamps us, says, you know, I'm a follower of Jesus? Well, we had baptism. Now, is there any magic in the water? Haleiwa Beach Park water? No, right? No, there's no magic in the water. It might be brown water today anyway, right? Because of all the runoff rain. There's no magic in the water. But you know what? It's an amazing symbolic act that we do in baptism. While we're saying, you know, the person says, I want to follow Jesus. So symbolically, what we say to the person kind of says, you know, we want to wash you of the old ways. And you're actually dying, you know, spiritually speaking, to that old person, because now you're saying yes to Jesus. His Spirit, Holy Spirit, comes into your life, and you come up afresh, anew. Some beautiful picture of this newness of life you have in following Jesus. That's one marker, you know. But baptism doesn't necessarily make you a follower of Christ. It just shows that you're a follower. Does that make sense? Now, another marker, another, really, what the Christian church calls it, a rite. Some denominations calls it a sacrament, something sacred, something special, set apart for those who follow Jesus. And that's what we're going to do right now. And we want to invite you. If you say, you know, I want to follow Jesus. Now, as we have learned, do you have to have all your questions answered about Jesus before you follow him? Of course not, right? I, in my role as pastor, I'm sure Pastor Mark, do you have all your questions answered? I'm looking forward to the day where I can talk to Jesus, you know, and say, hey, Jesus, how come it wasn't like this, you know? I still had this question about you, and he said, and obviously at that moment I'll learn. I'll be right there with Jesus. But until then, I'm still on a journey, and so you are you as well, in following Jesus and learning more about him. So that's why this moment where we say, you know what, I'm a believer, because I want to take this moment, because in the third year of Jesus' time with his disciples, he went up to Jerusalem and had dinner with his disciples. And everyone was expecting this Passover time where, you know, they wanted to remember what the Israelites went through when they were delivered from slavery, from Egypt, out into the wilderness and eventually to the promised land. Remember, then the angel of the Lord said, you know, we're going to pass over your house, because the Pharaoh said, you know, we're going to kill all the firstborns, right? So they put, like, blood on, you know, lamb's blood on the door frames. So they all throughout their history, they celebrated Passover, their deliverance. Well, they're all there, you know, having this Passover meal with Jesus, and Jesus says, okay, time out, guys. You see that bread on a table? It represents my body, which will be broken for you. And when you, every time you eat of it, and this is what he's telling them at dinner now. I don't think they're all hungry. They're, you know, eating, grinding. Jesus, why are you stopping us from eating right now? Okay, yeah. Okay, whatever, Jesus, you know. But he's saying, wait. When you eat of this bread, remember, this is what I did. And they're not even thinking of that, because they're thinking, Jesus, you're going to become king. You're going to sit on your throne. And I'm going to be on your right hand. And then, yeah, maybe Peter going to be on your left hand, but I want to be on your right hand. Now, after dinner, he takes the cup, and the cup says, this is the cup, and it's like wine, right? Red wine. So it kind of represents what? Blood, right? It looks like blood. So he said, hey, Jesus, master teacher, master amazing guy who can make connections. He said, you know, this represents my blood, and I'm going to bleed out for you. I'm going to bleed out, and it represents a new agreement, a new covenant. So what does that mean? Oh, yeah, well, whenever you drink of it, remember me, that I shed my blood. I bled out for you. Okay, shoots. Whatever, Jesus, I'm going to be on your right-hand side, though. And so they took it, not knowing exactly that that's what was going to happen. He was going to be broken, beaten, right? Flogged, as the Bible talks about. He's going to be tried. He's going to be convicted of murder, and he's going to hang on that cross. His body broken, blood being shed out, crown on his head, bleeding out. And so this morning we get to say, you know what? One marker, one way I can say I'm a Christian is I want to partake in that. I want to believe what you did, by taking in this symbolic representation of what you did on the cross. And that's why we have communion this morning. So ushers, can you come forward? Now, if you say to me, I'm still not certain about that, but you know, I want to believe. I want to, okay, this is all new, but you know what? You are welcome to join us. Does that make sense? Yeah, we're not going to have class right now saying, you know what, you believe 100% everything. We're not going to do that because the disciples didn't get it right. And Jesus still invited them for communion. Does that make sense? So if that's what happened 2,000 years ago, if you want to follow Jesus with all that you know right now, you partake with us. So go ahead, church, would you take a bread and a juice? Would you hold on to this as you're getting it? And would you just reflect upon that amazing act of what Jesus did for you? And this amazing response for all of us to take right now to say, yeah, we want to be followers. By saying, you know what? Jesus, this is what you did for me. I don't understand all the details about that. I don't even understand all the implications and what it means for me to do this. But you know, Jesus, I want to believe in you. You did this 2,000 years ago. You call me to have relationship with you in this time of communion. So take the time and reflect upon that. And when everyone has had a time to receive these elements, I'm going to pray. And together as a family of God, we'll take it up. Dear Jesus, this act right now of taking this bread piece, representing a broken piece of bread, and connecting that to what you did 2,000 years ago and having your body broken for us, is what we take in right now to remember you and to identify us with you as a follower. So church, go ahead. Would you take in his broken body? And Lord Jesus, right now I hold in my hand something that's symbolic of what you did on the cross. Think about all those lashes, all those whippings, and all that you had to bleed out for us to pay for all the things that we have done wrong. Lord, that was required. And right now we drink of this cup, which represents this new way of living, this new agreement you have with us, that no longer will we have to follow you by sacrificing animals anymore. You were the Lamb of God who sacrificed yourself for us and calls us into a relationship with you. So this morning, we as your church want to celebrate that fact as your followers. Go ahead, church. Well, if you want to go take this home and you practice communion at home, you can. You know, you can take it home. But the ushers will come around and they'll collect them because, you know, next time we're going to have communion again, right? No, we're not going to use the same cups. But would you right now turn to somebody that you haven't welcomed to church, and maybe they're a fellow follower. So if they're a fellow follower, what does that make you and I? We are brothers and sisters. So go ahead, say hi to our fellow brother and sister.
All right. Well, good morning, everyone. If we haven't met, I'm Pastor Mark, and I just want to, again, welcome you into the house of the Lord. And this morning, before we continue our service, we have a very special treat. As many of you know, tomorrow night is Halloween, and so here on parade, we have our children's ark in their amazing costumes this morning. So give them a hand. Woohoo! Ahoy there. Ahoy there, Eugene. And they're going to come out, and they're going to be handing out s'more materials to everybody. And so, you guys look awesome. And my two favorite back here in the Star Wars costumes. Sorry, I'm a little biased. I'm going to be Han Solo myself tomorrow. So you guys look, but you all look great. And just wanted to take this opportunity to say that, you know, if you have a heart for the keiki, for the kids, then our Children's and Toddlers Ark Ministries would love to have a conversation with you about raising up this next generation of leaders and of ministers of the gospel. And so go ahead, guys, hand out what you have, and they'll be going around handing that stuff out to you. But have a conversation with any of these leaders that you see in costume or wearing the orange shirts, and they'll let you know more about how you can get involved. And we're also in the process of renovating our Children's and Toddlers Ark rooms. And so if you want to know more about that, you can have a conversation with one of these leaders as well. Man, you guys look amazing. And while we're on that topic, just as a reminder, tomorrow night we do have our trunk or treat, our fall fest. And so in your bulletin, you should have this insert right here, the fall festival. And come out dressed in your best costumes, bring your kids out. It's going to be an outreach opportunity for families in the Wahiwa community, but all the campuses will be invited to participate in that. And we're going to have a trunk or treat tomorrow night. It's going to be a lot of fun. We'll be getting dressed up. There's going to be a costume contest, a lot of games and prizes. And so use this as either an invitation or as a reminder to yourself that it will be happening tomorrow night up at Iliahi Elementary. But before we go into the rest of the announcements this morning, I want to direct your attention to a couple of things that you should have received in your bulletin. And so if you take your bulletin out with me at this time, you should have received one when you came in. If you managed to slip by with that one, just put a hand in the air, and one of our amazing ushers will come by and make sure that you get one of these. But if you open it up with me, right there in the front, you should have received a little piece of paper like this, and this is our connection card. And especially if you're visiting us or you're our guest this morning, we want to encourage you to take the time to fill this out with your contact information, and that just helps us to get to know you a little better. But you can hold on to this to the end of service and respond in a number of different ways. On the front, you can inquire about different ministries that are being offered here in the church. And on the back, we especially want to encourage you to either leave a comment or a question or either a praise report or a prayer request. And we have an amazing prayer ministry team here at New Hope Central Oahu, and they pray for you all throughout the week. They love to hear from you and love to hear about how they can partner with you in what God is doing in your life. So please let us know any praise reports or prayer requests that are happening in your life, and we would love to lift those up with you this week. I also want to direct your attention. You should have received an envelope like this, and in just a little bit, we will be continuing our worship through the giving of our tithes and our offerings this morning. But if you're a visitor or a guest this morning, please don't feel any obligation to give. This is really an opportunity for those who call New Hope Central Oahu their home church to give. And so we're just blessed that you're here. We're praying that you would be blessed by the services as well. But we have a lot of other very exciting things going on. And so would you direct your attention to the screen and let's watch some of these together. Check this out.
It's time again for the Fall Festival, October 31st at Iliahi Elementary. There will be carloads of fun for young and old alike, including costumes, games, and a maze. And we need your help to make this event a success. We need donations of candy, cash, and time to make sure every kid goes home with a smile. Please see your campus coordinator to donate. Thanksgiving can be an incredible holiday full of food, friends, and smiles. What better way to celebrate the spirit of this holiday than to give of your time and talents to be sure everyone's day is full of food, friends, and smiles too. To help us do that, New Hope Central Oahu is organizing the 2016 Give Thanks Outreach to provide meals and show Christ's love to over 1,300 friends and neighbors in Central Oahu who might not otherwise have those things. We are looking for volunteers to help prepare food, cook, do crafts, deliver meals, and do visits, cleanup, and prayer. Shifts start from 4:30 a.m. all the way to 2 p.m. Donations of small toiletries, canned goods, etc. are also requested for blessing bags and hope bags for those in need. Help make this Thanksgiving truly a blessing for everyone this holiday season.
So that's a new series that we're going to begin in a couple of weeks after this follow series is done. And if you didn't catch it, it's called Hashtag Selfie, where we're going to be talking about how to live selflessly in the midst of a selfie culture and generation, how to live for the people and others in our lives. And so join us for that. And already we can be thinking about ways that we can live selflessly. You saw a couple of opportunities there. The Fall Festival, we still are receiving donations for that, candy, and anything else that you might wanna contribute. And then also I wanna highlight the Give Thanks event that is taking place on Thanksgiving Day. You should have received an insert in your bulletin like this. And you can use this to respond in a number of different ways by either donating food items, or you can donate of your time by helping us to prep food in the morning, or by being a driver to help deliver into the community. And you saw there last year we gave 1,300 meals out to the surrounding community, and we're praying that God will do an even bigger miracle this year. But you know, this isn't just for one generation, this is for all the generations, and even the youth are wanting to contribute and get involved, and they're going to be collecting toiletries, any goods you might have, and they're going to be putting together what's called blessing bags to be handed out with the meal. So with the meals, they will also receive toiletries, you know, goods that they can use. And if you want to donate that, they're going to be collecting it at both services as well. And so you can donate that up until the event, and they'll put those blessing bags together, and we will greatly appreciate that. One announcement you didn't see, but that I want to highlight, is that our men's retreat is also coming up. And if you haven't registered already, you can use this half sheet in your bulletin to register. This is going to be from November 10th through the 12th. That's Veterans Day weekend. And so the Friday you should have off, hopefully, and you can come and join us for the whole experience. Or if you can't, join us for as much of it as you can. And some of you have been looking at this and thinking, you know, I would really love to go, but maybe the cost is prohibitive. Please don't let that stand in the way of you registering for the men's retreat. If you have the time to go, if you have the margins to go, and if God is giving you a heart to go, then please register anyway. Just sign up. Let us know you're interested, and we would love to have a conversation with you about that. But please don't let cost be the reason you don't go. And so take a look at that. Check that out as well. And there's a whole bunch of other stuff going on, and you can check your bulletin for that or go online for more of that information. But at this time, you know, you heard from a very special man last weekend. He serves in our church as one of the leaders. He is the vice president of our board, and this morning he's going to share a little more. And so would you help me welcome up this morning Roy Helepololei as he comes to share a little more with us this morning. Got any jokes for us today?
I'm fresh out of jokes. Anyway, the reason why I'm up here today is, you know, we appreciate and we really love and cherish our pastors. But this is, you know, one time we get to show them how much we really love them and how much they've done for all of us. And that's really the purpose of a Pastor Appreciation Month. It's just to do all kinds of neat things for them, show them how much we appreciate for what they do for us throughout the year, for our churches, for our community, and for some of you, most of you, for you personally. And sometimes we forget that these guys are just humans, just like us. You know, they have their days. You know, they get angry, they get sad, they get distressed, they get hungry. They get tired, they get doubts, and yes, they even get tempted. But yet, they don't get to express that publicly. They process all of that privately. Not like we, you know, we can show our anger, we show our sadness, and we can go to them and we can ask them to pray for us. But do you know that they need prayer too? When they have these days, wouldn't it be nice if we could just go pray for them? You know, they don't get to come to us and say, hey, Roy, can you pray for me? Not normally. That's not what we expect from them. But wouldn't it be nice if we could just go up to them and say, I don't know what kind of day you're having, Pastor, but can I pray for you? Can I pray life into you? Wouldn't that be so neat to be able to do that? You know, these guys, they really care for us and they equip us. And most of all, they model Christ for us. You know, they don't. When you see them, it doesn't seem like they're having a bad day. It's always a smile, a kind thought, a prayer for you. So we need to show our appreciation for these gentlemen. And we can do that in several ways. We can show them how much we love them through our love offering. You could include them in your love offering. You can go up to them, talk to them, and thank them for all that they've done for you. I'm sure that we could express more thank yous to them. And another thing, you can take a pastor out to lunch. They would love that. And just sit down and talk story. You know, you don't even have to talk about anything in particular, but just have a good time with them and laugh and maybe even share a cry or two. So I want to call up our pastors, and if their wives are here, I would like to call them up too, because they're just a huge part of their lives is their wives. And I want to...
How did you know?
Thank you.
Anyway, if you would be so kind, if you just would extend your hand up towards the stage, I'd just like to say a prayer for all our hardworking pastors and their wives. Father God, it is by your love and grace that we here at New Hope Central Oahu have been gifted with these excellent pastors. They have been given to us by you, Lord, to lead and to guide us. We pray that you continue to inspire in each one your presence and your vision for the church. We shall continue to show these men our support, Lord, with prayers, kindness, and words of encouragement. We have so much to be thankful for this day, and we have been blessed by your abundance, and our cup overflows with goodness. I pray that the same spirit would resonate with each and every one of you as we gift these men with your love and your inspiration. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance to you and give you peace. And Lord, we ask that you bless the tithes and offerings this morning as we give, not only to you, Lord, but to our loving pastors and their families. We pray all of this in your name, and we all say, amen. And now I'd like to call back up Pastor Earl for the message this morning. Pastor Earl.
So ushers, would you come forward? And thank you so much for really this time of giving of your tithes and offerings. Really is a worship act of yours, saying, you know, God is the provider. Thank you so much for giving. And I know I speak for Pastor Mike, our senior pastor, and I speak for Pastor Mark as well, that we are honored, so honored to be given the role of pastors for all of you. And I speak for the other pastors at the other campuses, Pastor Laurie Shimobukuro at the Wahiwa campus, Pastor Glenn and Teresa Rosario, and Pastor Rich at the Haleiwa campus. And we, again, get to do this. And so thank you so much for your participation in seeing God's family grow and be a light and salt for the whole Central Oahu community. So give yourselves a hand for that as well. And many of you go, oh, I never know Pastor Earl was married, right? I don't see Gail at church, right? And, you know, it's nothing has changed in the last 10 years when I met her in high school. I was in math class in the front row, and she was in the back, always in the back. But I needed help with my math, and I was a smart guy, so I asked her to help me out. So she always sits in the back. You never see her, but that's okay. Still love her, right? Anyway. You are here in this series called Follow, and this is about the end of our series. Next week will be the final message in this series on Follow, where we have looked up close and personal at Jesus's life here on earth, where he called out and called his first followers to follow him. And if you recall, now these people that he called, right? Eventually, 2,000 years later, would lead the greatest religious movement of all time. It's the Christian movement. But these guys, when he called them, were they great government leaders? Were they great business giants? Were they? They were what? Fishermen, ordinary fishermen. And then God chose this other guy, a very notorious guy, who was a what? Tax collector. And these people represented the people that Jesus said, you know what? I see potential in you. I know, Matthew, I know what you're doing right now, but you're not going to be that guy. You're going to be a different guy. I'm going to use you to change the world with me. And this morning, we're going to look at, now, Jesus has been walking with these disciples. He called 12 of them eventually, right, as you know. And these guys are walking with him. And now this is the third year of Jesus walking with his disciples. And now these disciples are getting a little stronger now in their role. Now they're thinking, wow, Jesus, we are prominent. People know our name now. Because Jesus gave them the authority to go out and teach with him. Right, didn't he? He said, go out two by two, go teach. And you know what? Not only teach, you have the authority to cast out demons, because people, you know, were demon possessed, cast the demons out. And you know, the same kind of miraculous things I was doing, you can do too, so you can do that as well. So these guys are going out, healing people, right? Casting out demons, and these guys had a reputation now of being Jesus followers who would transform the whole region of Judea. And this morning, we're going to look at this encounter that Jesus had as they were going up to Jerusalem. As they were like going, and everyone was thinking, all right, Jesus, you're going to take the place on the throne of Judea and in the capital city of where? Jerusalem, right? They always go up to Jerusalem. And they were thinking, all right, Jesus, you're going to be the man. You're going to lead us as the king, just like how past centuries, King David was king, and he was an amazing king, religious and political king. You're going to be that king for us. And as Jesus is walking up, he gets to change their thinking about what great leadership is. So this morning, we're going to be talking about leading greatly, leading greatly. Let me ask you this question in the house. How many of you are leaders? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. How many of you are leaders? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's it? Okay. Let me give you a definition of leadership. Okay. You know this guy, John Maxwell? I mean, he's not Jesus, but John Maxwell, he writes about leadership and a guru on leadership. He says this: leadership is not about titles, positions, or power, or organizational charts. Leadership is about influencing another person's life. And I add the ability to make a difference and hopefully a positive difference in another person's life. Got that? So let me ask you this question now. How many of you are leaders? How come not all of you raise your hands? Okay, all of you raise your hands right now. Just entertain me. All of you raise your hands. You following what? How many of you are leaders? Okay, you know what? Whether you realize it or not, all of us are leaders. Why? Because we have influence on other people's lives. You may not have the position of leader, right? Or I would say not the position, I would say the title of leader in your organizational situation. But let me tell you, if you're married, right, you're a leader. Because let me tell you, you're the greatest influence on your spouse. You're a leader. Now, if you are a worker, you think, I'm not the boss guy, but aren't you in an area of responsibility? And you lead in that area. And you lead, and you have influence over others by the way you work. You're a leader. So all of us are leaders in some kind or the other. If you're a teacher, you have influence on your students. If you're a pastor, I hope we all have a positive influence on you. Friends, I hope you can have positive influences on your friends by speaking life, encouraging your friend, picking up them up when they're not, when they're needing some help, speaking into their lives when they're maybe walking in a way that's not right, and you speak life into them, you influence them. That's what a leader does. Not by a position or a title or someplace on an organizational chart, but we're all leaders. And Jesus addresses his disciple on this idea of leadership. And so I'm going to set up the scene this morning. Because again, it's the third year of Jesus now. He's going up to Jerusalem. Everyone is thinking you're going to take the role of leadership. And it's not in your notes, but you see all that scripture there? I'm going to have you us read together just a little prior to that so that we can catch up with what's going on in this situation. So Carl, would you show that scripture on the top there? And we will read it together. Ready? Go. They were now on the way up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. The disciples were filled with awe, and the people following behind were overwhelmed with fear. Taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus once more began to describe everything that was about to happen to him. "Listen," he said, "we're going up to Jerusalem, where the Son of Man will be betrayed to the leading priests and the teachers of religious law. They will sentence him to die and hand him over to the Romans. They will mock him, spit on him, flog him with a whip, and kill him. But after 3 days, he will rise again." Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came over and spoke to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do us a favor." "What is your request?" he asked. They replied, "When you sit on your glorious throne, we want to sit in the places of honor next to you, one on your right and the other on the left." Now, if you kind of take in this into consideration, picture this happening. Now, Jesus is walking up, right? He's ahead of them. And he says, "Okay, time out, guys." And they're all following him, right? Not only the 12, I'm sure the other people that already saw Jesus doing his miraculous things, and they wanted a piece of the action as well. So they're all following him, but Jesus calls a huddle. "Time out, guys. Okay, 12 guys, let's huddle." So he huddles, and he tells them the game plan, right? He tells them, "Okay, this is what's going to happen. The Son of Man is going to go up to Jerusalem, and he's going to be mocked, killed, spit on, right? Killed, and he's going to hang on the cross and die, and then he will be raised up in 3 days. Okay, got it, guys?" "Oh, okay." Right? And then, right, because what the two disciples' names? James and? You guys following, all right? So we too so easily forget, right? So James and John says, "Wait, time out. Jesus, we want to call our own huddle. So let's huddle. Okay. Jesus, when you sit on the throne," not the bachelor mind, you know, the throne, you know, "we like sit on the right and hand, left of you guys, of you, actually, because we, you know, people see us as, you know, great healers now and teachers now. We want to take that special place by you, you know, in your cabinet. You know, when you rule, we want that position. Okay, Jesus, get him." In fact, that James and John took them by themselves, right? They weren't with the other disciples. These guys was making, as we say in Hawaii, tantaran, eh? "Hey, we get him with you, Jesus. Remember us, eh?" Okay. Now let's read Jesus' response to those disciples. And it's in your notes right now. Let's read. "Then Jesus told them, 'You will indeed drink from my bitter cup and be baptized with my baptism and suffering. But I have no right to say who will sit on my right or my left. God has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen.' When the other disciples heard what James and John had said, they were," what does indignant mean? Huh? Habu, they were angry. They were peed off. You know what I mean? I mean, really, they were like, angry, indignant. We don't use that word, right? They were just like, what? Right? So, 42, "Jesus called them together and said, 'You know the rulers of this world lord it over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader," and who's the leader, everyone? We, you are, right? Right? "Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must be a slave of everyone else." The other disciples were indignant. They were angry, like, whoa, time out. And if I were Peter, I would be indignant myself. Because a few, right, I don't know, months ago, I'm the one that identified you as the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. I should be the one sitting at your right-hand side, Jesus, not these two guys. I'm the better fisherman anyway. You gotta have me sit over there, right? So they're probably talking. No. I have experienced the biggest change. And Matthew is speaking like this, right? I gonna take care of all the finances of the kingdom. Let me sit over here, right? And I don't know. I mean, that's not written in the Bible. I'm just thinking how these guys would be all talking. Arguing with one another. They became indignant, right? See, the disciples were expecting a different idea of leadership. They were thinking of the leadership model that was in place of that time. Somebody would be heavy-handed leadership. You're going to be like the leaders, these religious leaders now that were kind of put in place by the Roman government, right? And the Herods, the kings, right? That would control everyone with an iron fist. You got to follow all these rules and traditions of men. You got to live like this in order to be right with God, to be pono. So, right, we're going to change that. We're going to be like that too. We're going to force people to follow you, Jesus, just like how they did. That's what they were thinking. But Jesus says, no, time out. And he called a huddle again. It's going to be different among you. And who are leaders again? Yeah, all of you. Now, remember, it's going to be different with all of us. He's not just talking to the people then. He's 12. He's talking to all of us. It's going to be different. So in your notes, I want you to write, if all of us want to lead greatly, right, we have to do this. Put on our servant's uniform and serve. Put on our servant's uniform and serve. We got to do that. Yeah, put on your servant's uniform and serve. Yes. Now again, think about your life and the area of influence you have in your homes, in your workplaces, in the church. All of us have a position of influence. In other words, making a positive difference. Now, the ways of the world, and I'm sure you know the ways of the world because I'm sure you've had some negative examples of leadership. People who have been in these positions or are in these positions for themselves, right? I'm in it for myself. I'm in it for you to make me look good, right? You work here, you got to make me look good. I'm in it to win it for myself, and you just helping me, right, along. And I'm going to tell you what to do, right, so you better listen. Do we know some of these kind of leaders? You don't have to raise your hand, but yeah, we've all, I think, had, if we've lived long enough, some negative kind or bad example kind of leaders. Haven't we had those? That it's all about the titles. It's all about the position. All about your rank, right? And where you are. And you serve me. But Jesus says it's going to be different among you. And Jesus says, whoever wants to be a leader among you must be a servant. We always got to think about putting on that servant's uniform and serve. You know what a servant does when you think about a servant? What does a servant do? Think about it. What does a servant's job entail? What is it?
Right? Serve others?
Serve is the verb, right? He serves, right? So when you think about the word serve, what does serve others mean then? Yeah, submit to others. You're helping, right, to better the other person in some form, right, through some sort of action. You're helping to better that person. Are you that kind of person in your areas of influence? Fathers, mothers, sons and daughters, right? Are we in that kind of situation to actually serve, especially in marriages? Right? You know why marriages fail? Because I don't think people put on a servant's uniform in marriages. It's all about me, how you can serve me, rather than how can I make you a better person? How can I serve you in my role as a husband or wife? I think we'd have a better government system, a better educational system, if people had a servant's uniform that we put on. And we need to do that. Constantly remember to put on our servant's uniform as we serve. We have to honestly check and do a heart check, you know, on our lives. You know, and I got to do that a lot myself. You know, we are honored this morning as pastors, and I always got to remember. And I remember that this is so important that I have this carving in my house where Jesus is sitting down, kneeling, and he is washing, right, the feet of his disciples. I have that, and it reminds me that is my role, that I am, figuratively speaking, I'm a foot washer for Jesus. I'm serving others. That reminds me, I do that in my, I want to do that and be better at that in my household, in my relationship with my wife, everything. And you see, at New Hope Central Oahu, we are committed to developing leadership. In fact, that's one of our core values, leadership development. And what we do like Jesus, and we want to model this value like Jesus, is we want to believe early. We want to see potential in people early. Jesus did, right? He saw potential in Matthew. He saw potential in these fishermen that would say, you know what? Now, you've been fishing for fish. I want to help you to be fishers of men later. He saw potential. And that's what we want to do at New Hope Central Oahu. And you might not have a positional title in the church of like ministry leader or Ohana group leader or board, but you lead. But this morning, I want to take the opportunity, because as we have been identified as leaders, I want to introduce to you and honor the leaders that God has placed in our church to lead us well. So can I ask those who lead as the board members to rise? Not all our board members are here this morning. Can you rise this morning and be recognized? Right now. Roy Halapololei. As Dean Hazama, Roy is a retired Hawaii, Honolulu's finest police officer and Sheraton director of security, retired. Dean Hazama is the leader of the Mauka Neighborhood Board, and he's in his second retirement job. But anyway, that's Dean Hazama, and there are others that are serving with us. Can you thank them? Stay rich, stay standing. Okay, can you thank them? We have Les Lichtenberg, he's the guy to sound there. He's and then we have Dr. Brian Misaka, right? He is our resident Christian counselor. And we have another one of Honolulu's finest, Will Liu, and he serves on the board too. So give them a hand for leading us, to help Pastor Mike lead us fiscally well as a church, and strategically they help us. Okay, stand up. Continue stand. Now, we have other leaders in our church. We have many, many ministries, right? Service areas, right? Where people lead in servant leadership. So can I ask all the ministry leaders to stand up right now? You know who you are. I emailed you the other day. Be ready. So stand up. Right now. Jay Lee is there. Come on, stand up. Diane Park, refreshments. Bell over the youth. Stephen, you better stand up. I'm going to pull you up. Carrie Ishihara leads over the greeters, right? Helen, one of the leaders in her, why are you standing up, Helen? You're going on, where are you going on? David Usui, Connections Central. These are some of the ministry leaders in our church. Give them a hand. Remain standing. Now, can I ask all the Ohana group leaders to now stand? These are the ones that take care of people's souls, shepherd them to Jesus. Ray, would you stand up right now? Okay. Hollis and Carol Young, okay. Yes. Kerry Ishihara, he's standing up, he leads. Come on, aren't there more Ohana group leaders? Where's Kenneth Sentihara? He's my Ohana group leader. That guy taking the video over there. I mean, that's my Ohana group leader. Okay, they are the Ohana group leaders. Can I ask now the Transformation Academy instructors to stand? The other ones that teach us, Carol Miyashiro, and she's also Ohana group leader. I'm sorry. Ronnie Oki, you better stand up. I'm gonna pull you up. You teach us for Frida Financial. That's Ron Oki. Come on. I don't want to. Mel Otto, you better stand up, sister. You lead and help us with the co-ed softball. That's my ministry. Glenel, you better stand up. You an Ohana group leader. You, why are you sitting down? Glenel, Nita, she leads her. Yeah, these ladies, young ladies group. All of these are our leaders, our finest and best servant leaders of the church. Now, you know what? As a token, where Pastor Mike? I want to give you a token of our appreciation. Because what you do in each area of your leadership, your servant leadership, is you save lives. Okay? You're a lifesaver. And we are so grateful for your commint peppermint. Yeah? So we want to give you something to express our gratitude. Something small, okay? So, you know I'm a baseball guy, so you can catch that, right? Right? You can catch that. Roy, that's for you. And of course, I would hand it out to you. But guys, we have time. We have got a good time. This is for you. Remember your commitment to the Lord. And thank you. Give them a thanks, everybody. Diane here, catch. No, okay, right, it's for you. Okay, good, for you. Two, one time now. Come on. Okay, you got him. Ah, Butterfinger, thank you. You got one, Stephen. For you too, Vera. Yeah, good. Mel, ready, Mel. You may be seated. Thank them again. These are your servant leaders. They serve you well, modeling Jesus. Now I want you to write in number two. We got to leverage our authority to benefit those under your authority. That's what we got to do. Leverage. Jesus did this the best. He leveraged the authority. Now, just think now. He could have decided, say, you know what? Because I have healed people, I have taught well and amazingly well, I can lead well. You know, I can take the rightful place on the throne of Israel. But he didn't do that. See, got to be different, guys. That's not my plan. That's not the end game. I'm going to lead differently. In fact, I'm going to lead as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords for all eternity. I'm going to put aside my earthly position, because I could take that up. I'm going to lead in a different way. Because this is the kind of leadership he modeled. Let's read. And Paul talks about this kind of leadership in Philippians. It's this letter that he wrote to the Philippian church. And let's read it together. This is the kind of leadership where we leverage our authority to benefit those under our authority. Let's read. Ready, go. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. You read the rest of that chapter. It talks about Jesus. That Jesus became God. The universe became a man and lived out his life as a humble servant. That's why he says, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. That's not what leadership is about. Leadership is about thinking of how we can influence and promote others more important than us. That's what great leadership is. Taking the interest, the best interest of us. How many of you would like to follow that kind of leader in your workplace, in your families? Well, you know of that these people want my best interest in mind. How many of you? Only one or two people? Right, all of us. If you want that kind of leader, right, to follow, don't you think that people, right, will follow you if you can model that kind of heart, right? I want to be that kind of leader. Not for myself, but just for others, that they can be the best person God created them to be. That's the kind of leadership Jesus modeled, and he wanted to have instilled in the hearts of his leaders that would change the world, these servant leaders. Did you know that all these 12 would eventually, you know, right up to this time, they abandoned Jesus, right, when he was going to the cross? But you know, later when Jesus came and rose back from the dead, all these guys eventually in their life, did you know that they were all killed, they were all martyred for their faith? Right? Well, John was like exiled to this island, but pretty much, man, these guys experienced suffering. These guys died for Jesus. I'm not saying we will die for Jesus, right? We may not die like that. Probably won't. But because of Jesus' life with them, they said, you know what, Jesus? We know that this life is temporary. We're going to live on beyond. But you know what? We want to keep this movement going. This movement where people can get right with God just by believing you. And we want to be a part of that. So if it will require us to give up our life, count me in. I want to follow you. That's the kind of servant leadership we should have in our families. I'm going to sacrifice my life for you, whatever it takes. I'm going to be the best father, best mother, best husband, best wife, best coworker, whatever, for the family. I want to do that. That's why the question we should ask, because we are not like Jesus when we know the thoughts and attitudes of people. That's why we need to ask this question, what can I do to help? What can I do? You can write it in your notes. What can I do to help? What can I do to make you a better person, better worker? What can I do? What can I do? What can I do to help you? Don't wait to be asked. You ask. What can I do? What can I do? Mom and dad, what can I do? You know, friend, to be a better friend. What can I do? Better husband, to help, you know, be better family. What can I do to help? You gotta ask that question. Now I'm gonna give you a chance to hear from somebody who asks this question, what can I do to help? What can I do to help in his own way? Because he wants to make his workplace the best workplace possible to create a safe, productive working environment. I want you to hear an amazing story of this humble servant leader of God. He has a title, amazing title, but he doesn't live up to the world's idea of that title because he serves as Jesus would. Would you help me welcome up this project manager of the biggest project now on Schofield Barracks? You know the Schofield Barracks? You know the quad, they call it? You see them all in these movies, right? In World War I, they created this. This is a barracks that houses all these troops. He's in charge of the renovation project of that barracks. They cannot knock it down because it's a historic building. And he gets to oversee over 200 plus workers. And he serves as a servant leader. Would you help me welcome up Darren Iida?
Thanks, Pastor. Oh, guys, this is awesome. Thank you. Hi, my name is Darren. My wife Kelly is over there. My daughter is Allison in Sydney. We have been attending New Hope Central Oahu since the Ike School time frame. We started because we live up the street from Mililani Ike School, and on Sunday mornings, we will see a friendly-looking man waving at us. Then one day, out of nowhere, Kelly said, "Hurry up, get ready, let's go to church." And then I asked the one with the waving man. From that point, we actually took a step forward and walked across the bridge to Jesus, the most eternal decision we ever made. Next work weeks and Sunday church became our routine. During the work week, I work as an on-site senior project manager for the largest locally owned construction company. This is a photo taken this week of the same, this is a photo taken 100 years ago. And these were originally built during World War I. This next photo is taken this week of the same buildings we are now renovating. This is a large project with over 100 people working on site, and currently we're rushing to finish by the end of this year. Last week, when Pastor Earl invited me to speak in church about servant leadership, my immediate reaction and thought was, this is the worst time ever for me. With all the things going on, it'll be a better time later when the project is done and all the dust settles. But I asked God if I should speak, and he led me to Hebrews chapter 12. Later that morning, Pastor Earl called and informed me that Hebrews chapter 12 comes to his mind. We read a verse, verse 3 from that chapter, to consider Jesus who endured such opposition so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So per God's will, here I am speaking this very fast and condensed summary of God's work on the project site. At the start of the project in early 2014, we were having issues and difficulty getting the project going, and my counterpart, the project superintendent, said, "Maybe we should bless this place again. And it doesn't need to be another big celebration, a formal event with the media and the news." Then in faith, I prayed and asked God. I don't remember the exact words, but I remember my desire for God to guide us and to occupy and build the house. I prayed for God to not only fill the cup, but to have it overflow, and for God to take control and plan the event. Next, God responded to our prayers, rearranged our schedule, and almost 3 years ago, we set our house on God's word. Just at sunrise, we gathered, shared about God's goodness, and from Psalm 127, unless the Lord builds the house, the builder labor is in vain. And Pastor Earl said a prayer with us. Looking back, it was a miracle. We did not plan it this way, as it was the first day of pouring the building concrete foundations, Also, God works through the church, and by no coincidence, we're talking about setting our house on God's word, which is the only sure foundation. Looking back, it was a miracle. After the morning prayer, the safety manager informed me that he heard from God, and we will make prayer a part of every Monday morning safety meeting from now on. The year went by, and it seemed like anything and everything was going wrong, but we continued to pray and praise God. We saw miracles happen as he works through people to be ambassadors for Jesus. For example, the assistant safety manager God placed him on site to spread God's word. When someone yelled at him, "Hey, angel, what's God's word for today?" Then he responded by reciting God's words from the Bible, which literally stopped people in their tracks to listen. It is the power of God's word that changes the air. Or a quality control manager tangibly felt Jesus at her side, protecting and covering her in a meeting from discriminating words and attacks directed towards her. Or a foreman carpenter leading the concrete crew in prayer before pours. And by the way, we poured out the walls and foundations in record time. Or a journeyman electrician leading the guys to Jesus. I would overhear him asking his apprentices, "What is the most important decision you can make in life?" And God would show up again and again, like informing that the existing 100-year-old cement ceiling is going to collapse and closing the area to work. Then over the weekend, we were astonished that the entire ceiling collapsed. The workers would praise and thank God. Also similar, God informed that a tree is going to fall, and we stopped work in the area. Soon after, the tree did fall overnight. Praise God. Through the miracles, the guys would comment, "God is good all the time." They even wrote it on the walls. Also, what seemed to be a disaster, God communicated that judgment is his, and in his plan and perfect timing and date, he could place the devotion book on a windowsill open to this page, titled Spiritual Water. God communicated to us from John 4:13, "The water I give will become a spring of water gushing up inside, giving eternal life." And by no coincidence, the book was found at the same time frame we were experiencing multiple underground water line breaks around the job site. They were like springs of water gushing up to bring healing and covering the entire area. Also, no matter what we did, we could not shut off the water, and it overflowed into the surrounding community. This bridge shows a construction landscape which is so different from the beauty of nature. God said he is also here. God would speak to us to be ambassadors for Jesus and teach us the bridge illustration, and he would ask us to teach it to the people around us. For the following year, since the start of the project, we had many lost time accidents, like strained backs and necks, and one serious one where a worker with diabetes stepped on a nail, his foot got infected, and his toe needed to be amputated. This was hour zero. We had a safety stand down and another project blessing, and even in our lowest moments in time, we praised God. We invited Pastor Earl and Pastor Robert from the First Assembly of God to join us that morning. When the pastor started to speak, it started to rain really hard, and all the guys needed to come under the tent to stay dry, and in turn, they heard God's message. Then right after the gathering, the rain stopped, and later the guys commented, "That was God." Next, over 2015 and 16 from hour zero, by only God's grace, and to him goes all the glory, last week we celebrated 350,000 man hours with no lost time accidents. Pastor Earl and Robert again celebrated with us. And by no coincidence, I wrote my morning devotion prior to the celebration on God's word I dreamed about the night before. And to confirm, Pastor Earl texted me the same verse after I thanked him for attending the celebration. Thus, God's word to us and to you, the church, is, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Okay. Thank you. Actually, can I say a fast prayer with you? And then, Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us here today. We pray that you fill the church with your presence to overflow and for a great revival. Let us not be shaken. We commit our work to you, and please establish our plans. It is by your power that is at work within us that we can do more than we ask or imagine. Lord, shine your glory on the path that leads us to be leaders for you. We pray for strength to go out boldly into our daily lives as ambassadors for Jesus. To you goes all our praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children say, amen. Amen. Thank you. Thanks, Pastor.
Give God the glory. And, you know, Darren's heart the whole time, and he's the senior project manager. Look to him. He's the man on that project. But he's the man of God. There were so many things that were going wrong with the project, and it's still there's challenges today, but he said, you know what? I'm going to build this house for the future of the protection of our state and in our region, and to house these soldiers. I want to build it on a sure foundation for Jesus. He took a risk now. Non Inc. is not a company that necessarily says they're Christian. You know, this is a secular company with Christian, right? Christian, disguised as Christians there in every aspect. And he says, we're going to do that. I'm going to protect my workers. I'm going to have God come into this place. And when he took that step of faith, he said, I'm going to be the kind of servant leader. From that day, we prayed. In fact, that day he talked about when it was raining and all these construction workers were outside, they went into the tent. And I asked this question, guys, how many of you believe in God? You know how many people raised their hand? Everybody. Everybody. We believe in God. He said, shoot then. Let's believe that God will protect us. And then fast forward the tape. They get to celebrate a couple weeks ago. 350,000 no loss work hours. Isn't that amazing? You know how many lifetimes of people that is? This is a construction job now. This is not an office working job. This is construction. And we get the whole crew under Darren's servant leadership gets to praise God. Just think of the potential of all of us. That's Darren's story. Think of all our stories we get to be servant leaders, to serve, pointing people to their best interests and to really guide them to Jesus. Wouldn't that be amazing? That you get to turn people's hearts, that God gets to use you as a person of influence to usher people into the most eternal decision they can make, affecting their eternities by your actions of love. And this morning, I want to close in this idea, like, Jesus, you are a perfect example of that kind of leadership, and I want to follow you for all you've done. And at the kind of same heart of leadership as a servant, I want to become that kind of servant for those in my life, because I want them to be the best person they can be. And if, God, you can use me to lead them to you, Lord, use me. I want to pray in response to our amazing, amazing Savior who leads us well. Could we pray? Heavenly Father, this morning I am here. And I heard this amazing story. Someone who went out on a limb and said, you know what, I'm going to stand up for you, Jesus. I'm going to serve as a servant leader. I might get some flack for that, but I'm going to go out on a limb and do that. I'm going to consider you, Jesus, who endured such opposition from sinful men so that I will not grow weary and lose heart. And Lord Jesus, I know in my area of leadership, I am so tempted to just throw in the towel, give up, and I am weary. But Lord, you say to consider you and what you did for us. And Lord, your leadership of kindness, your leadership has drawn me to you. Not a heavy-handed leadership, but leadership that would say, I want a relationship with you so much so that I will come down and identify with you in all the situations that you go through, the difficult times, your good times, and I'm going to be there to carry you through. I'm going to be there to lead you to a life everlasting with me. But in the meantime, I want to use you as well to lead others to me. But it starts with that first step. If you're here this morning, if you've never said yes to this amazing leader, Jesus, in your heart by saying, yes, I open my heart to him. The Bible said, yet to all those who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And if you want to become a child of God, you want to be called a Christian, identified as someone who follows this amazing leader this morning, you can say, yes, I want to believe in Jesus this morning. Just by saying, yes, Jesus, yes to Jesus right now. And if that's you this morning, if you never had that tangible fact to say, I am yours, Jesus, would you this morning, would you look up at me and say, you know what, that's my decision this morning. I want to make Jesus the God of my life. I want to follow him. Look at me and I'll say, yes, that's what God wants. Is that what you want? Good. God sees you. Anybody else? God sees you too. You too. God sees you. God sees you too. Be a follower. Anyone else? For those who looked up and said, you know what, I want to follow this amazing Savior, amazing leader of my life that's going to take care of me, would you pray this prayer just under your heart, saying, Jesus, I believe in you. Go ahead, church. We'll do that together. Jesus, I believe in you. I receive into my heart. I want to be called a child of yours. Thank you for forgiving me of my sins. Thank you for coming to my life. I want to live for you, Jesus. I want to have you be in charge of my life. I may not have all my questions answered, but I follow you, Jesus. You're my Savior. You're my Lord. You're my leader. And I praise you. Go ahead, church, give him a hand. You know, if any one of you said, you know, this morning, I wanted to just confirm in my heart that I made the decision to follow Jesus. You know, we have the connection card that Pastor Mark talked about. Would you just say, you know what? I made the decision to follow Jesus. And, you know, maybe you saw people getting baptized before and you go, wow, you know what? I want to get baptized now because I want to tell others about the decision I made to follow Jesus and put a stamp on my decision and make it public. So maybe you need to say, I want to be baptized the next time we have baptism. Or if you want, we can go out today. Get baptized. For real kind. We can. But if you want to wait, we can have another one planned. Or tell us what God spoke to you this morning. Or if you want to talk to Darren and just give him thanks for his inspirational servant leadership role he has, just give him thanks after church. But can we go out in praising God? Because of our Lord Jesus Christ is a God of kindness and he draws us to change because of his kindness. Let's sing this song.
Open up the skies of mercy.
Open up the skies of mercy. Rain down the cleansing flood. Rain down. Your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. And it's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. Your love is better than life.
We have amazing Savior, a Savior leader, a servant leader. Isn't he amazing, church? and we get to follow him. And you know what is even amazing? He wants to use you and I to show others the amazing Savior we have. Is that good news? Would you go into the world and be an amazing, amazing leader, servant leader for Jesus? Until next week. And help the future leaders of our church by going and supporting them with the fundraiser we have now for the future leaders of our church in the world. Aloha.
It's your kindness.
And it's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. And it's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. Your love,
it's your kindness.
And it's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. And it's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. Your